The Beef Market Update on RealAgriculture.com with Ann Dunford is brought to you by AFSC's Cattle Price Insurance Program, Haney Farms, and Gateway Livestock Exchange. And when we look at the basis levels, historically, where are we sitting?
Well, on both fat cattle and feeder cattle, Sean, we've got considerably narrower, or I guess the proper term is stronger basis levels than we've historically seen in recent years, and even seen pre-2003. And so let's dissect both of those. First of all, let's talk about feeder cattle. Very strong basis there. And, I mean, we know we've been talking about for some time now the contraction of the Canadian cow herd, cattle numbers, feeder cattle supplies. And it's been a long time coming, but I think, and basis is a very good signal that takes out all the emotion and the Canadian dollar impacts and those kinds of things. And it's a very good signal that vis-a-vis the U.S., Canadian feeder cattle are trading at some of the best levels they have historically, or from a basis comparison sake. So it's telling us supplies are tight. I think there's a key storyline there. On the fat cattle side, we still export fat cattle on a week-to-week basis, but most certainly fewer on a cash basis than we have historically been doing or in recent years. And again, I think the storyline is simply supplies are tightening, and if that's the case, if the Canadian packers having to pay closer to the U.S. price to keep the cattle here in Canada or in Western Canada, then I think you could probably make the next assumption that he's probably doing a better job than he used to selling that beef. And you know, as time marches on, I think we'll be able to feel more confident or comfortable with those scenarios or that assumption. But I think right now, if you were to pin me in a corner, that would be my response.
So do you have a reason why they're having better success domestically than they originally thought they would be?
Could it simply be the focus? You know, there's no question there's been an expansion in the branded beef markets and some of the niche markets that they've been focusing and going after. And again, I just do you focus more on home versus the U.S. market when that was a good place of beef, but I don't think there was any strong premiums attached to that on a week-to-week basis.
Could be the Canadian economy is just doing better in general when we compare it to the U.S.
Yeah, you could say that. Our beef consumption levels still look like they're losing some ground, but at the same time, in this recession, you can also see what's happened, and we've seen it pretty clearly on the cull cow side of the market. Of course, hamburger consumption has gone the other way in this recession, and people are consuming more hamburger and willing to pay more money for it. So been very interesting shifts, and you know, whether you tie it down to recession impacts, cattle supply impacts, Canadian versus U.S., and again, exchange rate having potentially an impact on, you know, at a par dollar, do you focus more on doing a better job at home? You're not as good an exporter as you were when you were at a 65-cent Canadian dollar.
Right, but if we're going to have strong basis numbers and getting a little shorter on supply on the fat cattle side, do we see the packer, you know, and trying to and still buying 3 weeks out? Do we see the packer cutting more kill days?
I think we've seen the worst of that now, Sean. Again, some seasonal patterns there. I think we are sensing even as of today that lifting time has been narrowed a little bit. I think, you know, some of the business that was done today was closer to 2 weeks out. So, again, we've seen that before and it hasn't held on, but we'll see if there's any last to that. But I do think with the stronger cutout we've seen in the U.S. this week, yeah, U.S. kills have not been cut. No, I think the worst of the cuts on fed cattle kills are I'm going to suggest, behind us.
Okay. What about carcass weights? What have we seen with carcass weights lately?
Well, and there's another what I'm going to define as a supportive fat carcass weights. As I mentioned, my weekly last week, a couple pounds, well, most certainly off the top of 2 weeks ago. And seasonally, this is about when we peak our fall or winter carcass weights. They're well under the levels we saw last year, and they've turned over. And so from here out to the end of the year, as we get into these shorter-fed grass cattle, you tend to not see weight climb drastically higher unless we get into a holding pattern. And I don't think with cost of gains and with grains looking like they're going to inch higher that there's going to be a dramatic shift towards putting more pounds on these cattle than we already have. So I think you're going to see carcass weights continue to trend lower through the end of the year, and that will be a positive story for the overall supply tonnage story.
Does that have, when the carcass weight, we kind of reach our peak for carcass weights, does that have, what is the price correlation on the fat cattle side to that?
As far as discounts, well, or are you lost?
Yeah, just in terms of, like, is this the time where we see, what happens with the price? It typically where we hit this peak. Where does the price usually go from a
seasonal perspective, that's right. You know, you have your spring high, and then often we'll rally back in the late fall to get close to those levels, and that's exactly what we did on the Alberta pricing, April versus what we saw there, a few weeks ago. So that's a seasonal peak. Again, more a supply scenario versus an actual carcass weight scenario.
Okay. What are we? The Canadian dollar's kind of been bouncing around. Any feedback on the dollar in terms of the producers you've been talking to?
Oh, well, there's no question. The drop in the dollar on Monday most certainly, and Tuesday most certainly, gave us some opportunities to get some stronger pricing going on here in the domestic marketplace on fat cattle this week. So prices are higher today, and it's a direct result of the weaker Canadian dollar we've seen. And of course, you know, that's all stemming back to continued concern about the state of the various EU countries. Of course, earlier we were talking about Greece a few months ago, and now the storylines around Ireland and the debt concerns going on there. And then, of course, China making some comments in regard to ways that they're going to be looking to keep a lid on inflation and some mechanisms and measures they need to turn into. So all of a sudden we've got, you know, concern out there globally again about how the world is coming out of this recession, this latest recession. And again, that's meant U.S. dollar strength and resulted in Canadian dollar weakness. So it's been a puff this week, but again, lots of economic news driving that.
Yeah. Kian, thanks a lot, and we'll talk to you again next week.
Okay, thanks, Sean.